Hi, welcome to Canyons and Crags in the American Canyoneering Academy. This is Rich Carlson. In today's video, we're going to talk about knot tying and webbing. We are going to be tying knots and bends in our webbing. All of them are going to be variations of an overhand. Very simple to tie. All we're doing is taking the tail, passing it around the main strand, and pulling it through a loop. Very simple. Everybody knows how to tie an overhand. A bend is any time we bring two ends of a material together and connect them. To tie this particular bend, what I'm going to do is take the tail and tie a simple overhand. Once I've tied that overhand knot, I'm going to bring the other end of the webbing and bring it up the front of the short tail. What I'm looking for here is the side that looks the most like a man's necktie. So that'll be this side, not this side. Once I've brought that tail up, I'm going to pass it through the first loop and continue so the piece that I'm tying with stays on top of its mate strand. So I'm going to continue and it finally comes out here. If I did this correctly, a simple check is to look to make sure there's two strands coming out of both ends and that everywhere inside of the tie there are two strands. When you're tying the webbing, we want to make sure that we have at least 4 inches of tail on either side. If you're not sure what 4 inches is in the field, just use the width of your hand and make sure that it's at least as long as the width of your hand. Another common tie in webbing is an overhand on a bite. A bite is just simply a fold in the webbing. Once I've folded it over and given myself enough material to tie the knot and leave the appropriate amount of tail, I just tie a simple overhand. Once I've tied the overhand on a bite, one of the things I want to look at is the amount of gain I have. Gain is the distance from the knot to the outside of the loop. If the only thing you're going to put in this loop is a carabiner or a rappel ring, there's no need for this thing to be excessive in size. And again, I'm checking my tail, making sure I have at least 4 inches. Another way you might want to tie this overhand on occasion is what's called a re-threaded overhand. In this case, what I've done is I've tied my overhand knot in a single strand of webbing and left myself enough tail to go around an object. Once I've gone around that object, I'm going to start my re-threading from this direction. Other than the direction that I'm re-threading, it's exactly the same as tying an overhand bend. The result is going to make this look very much like it did when I tied an overhand on a bite. The difference is this is already around an object. When you're choosing between tying a re-threaded overhand knot and a re-threaded overhand bend, one of the important things to look at is the direction that you're loading the knot or bend. We always want to load on the major axis. One visual cue you can use to readily identify whether you've tied a knot or a bend is that knots tend to look like a man's necktie and bends tend to look like a man's bow tie. This becomes important when you're looking at how you're going to load your knot or bend. What I've tied here around this tree is a bend. Here I'm going to put a rappel ring, and when I load the loop that I've tied around the tree, the bend is loaded in the correct direction. What I've tied this time is the webbing around the tree using a re-threaded overhand knot. I did it this time because my goal is to extend the single strand of webbing out to the edge because my anchor is quite a ways back. So in this case, you can see again, I'm loading the major axis of the knot. You'll hear a lot of people talk about the way that they tie their webbing as though there's only one right way to do it. Instead, what we should be doing is modifying the way we tie webbing based on what we need to accomplish. Position refers to two things. First, the location of the focal point where we install our rappel ring. This location is often critical to reliable rope pulls. Second, the position of the webbing around the anchor. It is advantageous to rig high whenever possible to facilitate easier rappel starts, lowering and belaying, and to allow for smooth rope pulls. When it is not possible to avoid positioning our webbing where there is a risk of it being cut or abraded over sharp or coarse rock,
The webbing should be tight to provide redundancy. We want all of the components in our anchor and rigging, including the webbing, to be strong enough to handle the task at hand, plus provide an additional margin of safety. There are simple ways to tie webbing that will increase webbing strength, and some ways that will actually weaken it. With training and practice, you will learn simpler and cleaner ways to rig anchors. That includes ways to rig and tie webbing. Efficiency also refers to ways you can rig to move your group through problems more quickly and safely. Equalization certainly applies to multi-point anchors, but in some instances it can apply to single-point anchors as well. Improperly rigged webbing may slide around the anchor, creating greater risk of abrasion and possibly damaging natural anchors. That applies to trees and bushes, as well as soft rock like sandstone. Now let's go outside and look at some ways we can tie and rig webbing to address these principles. Let's start with a simple, single-strand wrap around our anchor. Most anchors are strongest at the bottom, where the feature is thickest and we apply the least amount of leverage. When in your good judgment the anchor is strong enough, rig higher. This tree has a branch on the back to hold the webbing in position. 1-inch tubular webbing has a rated strength around 4,000 pounds. If the angle made by the two legs of webbing at the focal point is zero, we benefit from the strength of two strands of webbing, around 8,000 pounds. The wider the angle, the lower the strength. A knot or bend tied in webbing will also lower the strength, for the sake of this conversation, by about 1/3. Some people choose to locate the knot or bend where they can see it. However, you will retain more of the webbing strength if you position it where it will be under the least amount of tension. Moving the bend to the back of this tree allows friction to take some of the tension off of the bend. Note that I did not tie an overhand knot at the focal point. Doing so would accomplish nothing except to add a second weak point to the webbing. Leaving the rappel ring free to slide back and forth on the webbing will allow for some equalization without causing the webbing to slide around the tree, potentially damaging the tree. I'm not concerned about the bark of this juniper tree cutting my webbing, and the webbing does not hang over any sharp or coarse rock, so I am not concerned about redundancy. This single-strand wrap was quick to tie and simple for a partner to inspect. Another method for rigging a simple wrap is to use a frost knot. This method has the advantage of being very quick once you have practiced it. Two disadvantages, though. You can't move the knot to the back of the tree to take some of the tension off, and because there is a knot at the focal point, any equalization needed will occur by the webbing sliding side to side on the anchor. Use it in situations where you do not anticipate any lateral movement or when lateral movement will not damage the anchor. There is no need to guess the length of webbing required in cutting it prior to tying. Tie the frost knot as shown, folding over the long side of the webbing. Get the angle the way you want it, position the focal point where you want it, then trim off the excess webbing. As the name implies, wrap 2 pull 1 rigging involves wrapping the webbing around the anchor twice, connecting the tails with an overhand bend, then pulling on one strand. Pull on the strand that does not include the bend and position the bend on the front of the anchor where it will be subjected to virtually no tension. Using this rigging method, the webbing will cinch down on the anchor to hold it in place when under tension, a good option when there are no natural features on the anchor to hold it in place. On occasion, you will encounter wrap 2 pull 1 rigging with an overhand knot tight at the focal point. The overhand knot is pointless. It does not add redundancy. It adds an unnecessary weak point in the webbing, and it hinders equalization. Better to forego the overhand knot and allow the rappel ring to provide equalization by sliding side to side on the webbing. Wrap 3 pull 2 rigging is favored by rescue teams due to the strength it provides. That strength may be overkill for a simple rappel anchor. Like the wrap 2 pull 1, this rigging will cinch in position when under load. It does not provide redundancy. If you encounter a situation where you want the strength of wrap 3 pull 2, but you also need redundancy, you can use a redundant wrap 2 pull 1. Simply fold a length of webbing in half and use the double strands in pairs. Wrap the pairs of strands around the anchor twice and tie an overhand bend by rethreading one pair. Pull on the pair of strands that do not include the bend and position the bend on the front of the anchor. Here is a quick tie variation of the redundant wrap 2 pull 1. It is redundant everywhere except the focal point, which should be located where it will not incur any abrasion anyway. Like other wrap and pull rigging methods, it cinches in position when under load. It does lose some strength compared to the previous method due to the overhand not being under tension, but it is still plenty strong for most purposes. To rig a basket around an anchor, start with a loop of webbing. Pass a loop around the back of the anchor and bring the two end loops together. It is quick and strong, but not redundant and will not cinch in position. You can create a redundant basket by tying an overhand knot at the end of the loops. You do lose a bit of strength due to the overhand knot being under tension, but it is still plenty strong for most purposes. This is a quick tie version of a redundant basket. Start with a length of webbing folded in half. Bring the doubled webbing around the anchor and tie an overhand knot where the loop and the two tails come together. It is similar to the quick tie version of the redundant wrap 2 pull 1, but will not cinch in position. In this variation of a girth hitch, I started with a loop of webbing. Some people choose a girth hitch over wrap and pull rigging when they want their webbing to cinch in place because it tends to be quicker to set up. There is a strength loss to consider, however, especially if you position the girth hitch to maximize the cinching. This is a threaded eye variation of a girth hitch. It starts with an overhand knot on a bite in one end of the webbing, then pulling the other end of the webbing through the eye. Like the loop variation, there is a strength loss to consider. Some people argue that despite the strength loss, a girth hitch is still plenty strong for a rappel anchor. That's true, but it only takes an extra few seconds to set up wrap and pull rigging. The term courtesy rigging refers to a system that provides everyone in a group, except the last person, with the ability to rig and start their rappel back away from the edge. The last person repositions the rappel ring over the edge for an easy rope pull, but they are forced to deal with a trickier rappel start. There are a variety of ways to set up courtesy rigging. Presented here are a few of my favorites. The first method starts with a frost knot to create the courtesy rigging point for everyone except that last person. To create the second rigging point, the one that will be extended over the edge for the last person after everyone else is down, rethread the tail of a second piece of webbing through the frost knot as shown. Be sure to leave adequate tails and have someone else inspect the knot. Now clip a carabiner into the loop of the frost knot. Pull up the far end of the extended piece of webbing and clip the rappel ring into the carabiner. Note that the rappel ring is connected to an overhand knot on a bite at the end of the webbing. You can rig single, twin, or double rope systems just like you normally would for everyone except the last person down. Once everyone else is down, the last person unclips the rappel ring from the carabiner and sets the rappel ring over the edge. Do you see two overhand knots in the single strand of webbing? I folded the webbing over, then tied the two knots to provide redundant strands. The webbing is only redundant between the knots where the webbing runs over the edge and is most likely to be abraded. The next method for setting up courtesy rigging involves a rethreaded frost knot. It only requires one piece of webbing that is long enough to go around the anchor and extend over the edge. Start by establishing the location of the overhand knot that will be rethreaded. Instead of rethreading this knot with the tail of the webbing like you normally would, Fold the tail over to create a bite and rethread with the bite. When you are finished tying, double check yourself, then have one of your partners check it. Make certain that there are 3 strands of webbing coming out of both ends of the knot and that there are 3 strands everywhere inside of the knot. It is possible to accidentally tie a slip knot, so be sure to test it in a safe position before anyone goes over the edge. This last method involves a simple rethreaded overhand knot in the extended piece of webbing that will be used by the last person down, plus a separate sling for the courtesy rigging for everyone else. I prefer using a simple basket for the courtesy rigging because it is simple and quick for the last person down to remove it. That's it for this episode of The Art of Canyoneering. Thank you for watching. If you'd like to see more videos like this, subscribe to my channel.